Hello everyone. My name is Steve Ouimette, the Deputy Technical Director here at the Naval Surface Warfare Center Carderock Division. We are one of the premier Navy laboratories for designing, testing, and evaluating ship, submarine, and unmanned systems designs. And we've been doing that for over 120 years here at our West Bethesda site. It first started back in the late 1800s when Rear Admiral David Taylor graduated from the Naval Academy first in his class as a naval architect, and he perfected a lot of the experimental techniques that we use today to evaluate and predict full-scale performance of Navy ships. Here at West Bethesda, we have some of the world-class hydrodynamic, structural, and signatures test facilities. And we're going to go out on a tour right now and show you some of those facilities. Before we go on our tour, I want to just take a minute and talk about some of the other sites that we have associated with the Carderock Division. On the West Coast, we have detachments that do signatures, evaluations, and testing on Navy ships and submarines for the West Coast fleet. We have facilities on the East Coast that support the East Coast fleet of ships and submarines. We also have a detachment down in the Norfolk area, our Combatant Craft Division. They do design, testing, and evaluation of all Navy small boats and crafts. We also have a detachment in Memphis, Tennessee, our large cavitation channel. It's a unique hydrodynamic facility with a circulating water channel that can do testing on large-scale ships and submarines. So now we're ready for our tour. Let's go. Our first stop on the ship design tour really begins on a computer. This is where our modeling and simulation tools help our engineers and scientists design the next generation of ships, submarines, and unmanned systems. Once those designs are determined to be feasible, then we go to the next step, which is developing scale models and testing them in our facilities. The results of these tests can then validate those computer models. So let's go on to the first facility. The first stop on our tour is the world-famous David Taylor Model Basin, named after Rear Admiral David Taylor. Constructed in the late 1930s, these tow tanks consist of actually two basins, a 50-foot wide basin and a 22-foot wide basin, and they contain over 30 million gallons of water. There's a series of carriages on each of the basins that will tow surface ships or submarine models through the water, and we can test up to about a 30-foot model. When we run the model through the water, we're collecting hydrodynamic data, and this data is going to be used in the final design of the ship and/or submarine. The unique features of this basin is from one end of the basin all the way to the other end of the basin is 5/8 of a mile long. Another unique feature of this tow tank is that the rails follow the curvature of the earth, because the water from one end all the way to the other end also follows the curvature of the earth. It's affected by gravity. Back in the 1930s, constructing this was an engineering feat in and of itself. The testing that we do here in the model basin is for powering and resistance. This will help us determine how much thrust is required and how much horsepower is required aboard the ship in order to overcome the drag that the ship has as it goes through the water. We have other facilities that test other hydrodynamic characteristics, so that's where we're going to go next. Welcome to the Maneuvering and Seakeeping Basin, or what we call the MASC. This is our wave maker that produces waves where we test our scale models in different sea state conditions so that we can determine the seakeeping properties of the ships. The waves are produced in this basin by paddle mechanisms. There are 216 paddles that extend along one long end of the rectangle and short end of the rectangle. These 216 paddles are computer controlled and work in unison with each other to produce the wave pattern that we're interested in. And like your fingerprint, there are different wave patterns around the world. Through satellite and buoy data, we've been able to collect the wave energy spectrums of the oceans around the world and can replicate it here, so that when we test our scale models in this wave tank, we're actually mimicking the actual sea state conditions that a full-scale ship would experience. By measuring the maneuvering and seakeeping of the vessel and matching it with the data we've collected at the David Taylor Model Basin for resistance and powering, we now have a really good idea of the hydrodynamic performance of that model. And we can accurately predict what the full-scale performance of that ship is going to be once it gets built. And this is just another way that we're collecting all of the data to accurately predict the performance of the ship. Besides the David Taylor Model Basin and the Maneuvering and Seakeeping Basin, we also have water tunnels and water channels where we're doing experimentation on scale models. Again, trying to characterize the full performance of that vessel so that we can accurately predict its full-scale performance. So you've heard me talk about all of the hydrodynamic facilities that we have here at Carderock. Now I'm going to talk a little bit about the aerodynamic facilities that we have. Behind me is one of those examples. This is the 8x10 subsonic wind tunnel. We do a variety of experimentations in here, but of late, we've been using this facility to help characterize the airflow around the top side of a Navy ship. And that's really important because we fly a lot of manned and unmanned aerial vehicles off of Navy ships. So we really have to characterize the flow to know where to put those launch and recovery stations aboard a ship. We're also interested in all the other air intakes and exhausts that we have aboard a ship. So this is just another example of how we try to predict the performance of a ship, characterize its performance, and make sure that it's a good, feasible design. The next stop on our tour is the Manufacturing Knowledge and Education Lab, or what we call the MAKE Lab. This is where we experiment with 3D printers or additive manufacturing. These devices can print from a computer-aided design computer file a part, and they can make that part out of polymers or all the way up to metals. And this is important. We're trying to do two things here. One is provide a resource for the employees here at Carderock to do rapid prototyping. If they've got a design of something, whether that be a ship, a part, a system, they can come here and print it, and they can see for themselves what that part is and how it works. The other thing is, we're experimenting for the Navy how to deploy 3D printers aboard Navy ships. And the important thing is, we want to make sure that the specification of the part produced on an additive manufacturing machine is actually up to the same specification and standards that a typical Navy part would be. And so that's why this is important, to develop the research for this and to do experimentation on 3D printing. Another aspect of the ship design process is to make sure that our ships and submarines are designed to withstand the environment that they're going to operate in. And that means that they have to have the structural integrity to withstand the loads. If it's a surface ship, all of the loads that the waves impart on the hull. And if it's a submarine or submersible, then the pressure that's caused by going at certain depths. So one of the many structural facilities that we have on Carderock is the deep submerged pressure tank. And that pressure tank behind me is the largest in the US. It's 13 feet in diameter and 40 feet deep. And within this pressure tank, we can put scale models of submarines or submersible hulls in the tank, fill it with water, pressurize it, and simulate those depths before the sub is even built or goes to those depths. So by learning how the scale model reacts and how the loads are imparted throughout its structure, we can predict how the full-scale submarine will be able to withstand those. One of our goals here at Carderock Division is to make sure that the ships and submarines we design are as stealthy as possible. And that means we have to have good signature management. And the signatures I'm talking about are what's emitted from our ships, whether they're surface ships or whether they're ships that are under the water. And no matter what size they are, every ship emits a certain signature. And the signature can be across the electromagnetic spectrum. It can be infrared to radar to visual and acoustics. And we're concerned with making sure that we manage all of those signatures to make sure that the ships and submarines are as least detectable as possible. To do this, we have a variety of measurement facilities. One of these is the Magnetics Fields Labs, and that's where I'm at right now. The building is unique in the US Navy because it is built to be as non-magnetic as possible. So it is built out of non-ferrous materials, We have wooden doors, a wooden ceiling and roof. We have composite structures throughout, and we even have special concrete. In here, we test scale models of ships and submarines that are magnetically faithful to their full-scale cousins out there in the fleet. This facility is great because we can replicate any magnetic field on Earth. So we can test how the ship performs in the Mediterranean or in the South Pacific. We also have facilities around the world that allow us to measure and compensate for ships and submarine signatures to keep our platforms safe. This stealth technology that Carderock helps develop protects our ships against torpedoes, mines, and enemy detection systems. And most importantly, they help keep our sailors safe out at sea. So up to this point in our tour, we've been talking about engineered models, engineering models that we test in our facilities to gain information about the design of a ship or a submarine. But we're gonna finish our tour today down here at the Curator shop. The Curator shop is housed here at Carderock, and it is made up of artists who are responsible for the care and maintenance of over 3,500 display models. These are display models of Navy ships that are exact replicas, so it's a historical record of that ship. And we have models that are 100 years old that are representative of old ships that were once deployed by the Navy. The curator is responsible for the care and maintenance of those models through the years, so that there's a historical record for years to come. So thank you very much for joining me today on this tour. I hope you had an appreciation for what the Naval Surface Warfare Center Carderock does for the United States Navy. It truly is where the fleet begins.